Well, good morning, everyone. I'm Lars Rasmussen. I'm the Assistant Garden Supervisor for Plant Health. And I'm here in the Cherry Border at Swarthmore College, Scott Arboretum. And I want to talk to you today about some different pest issues that we're starting to deal with and we will be dealing with probably the rest of the year, but mainly in mid-May is when things really get active. And today I want to talk about three topics that you'll all be looking at when dealing with the insects, especially. And you're going to be hearing them too. I'm going to talk about Brudex cicadas, and I'm going to talk about scale issues that we're having, and also something about spotted lanternfly. So hang on with that. And I'm looking at two different kinds of Styrax. We have Styrax japonica over in the left here. On the right, we have Styrax abasia, which is a native Styrax. And lanternfly really likes Styrax. It's one of their favorites, along with the obvious Ailanthus and red maple, silver maple, river birch. But when you have lanternfly, which is a plant hopper, which secretes a lot of honeydew, which turns into sooty mold, you also have to think, if you're a tree and they're way up there and they're doing all that, their business, that all that's coming down on the understory. So this is a azalea that's directly underneath the Styrax japonica. And so this got hit pretty hard with a lot of honeydew, which turned into sooty mold. So you'll see a lot of dieback and blackening of all the stems, and that's kind of the sooty mold you're seeing, and the regrowth isn't there, the health isn't there as much as it used to, but you are seeing maybe some new growth on the inside of the plant. So that's it's the azalea's way of reacting and responding to that. Now this Ailanthus, I was looking at because I couldn't understand why it was so healthy. And it's healthy because it's in between these two and it doesn't have that much canopy where the honeydew's raining down on it. And then I was looking at it and I was looking for any evidence of scale issues, because they do tend to have, and here, if you can see it right at this axle where these twigs meet, there's azalea bark scale here. And it's not, it isn't in high numbers, but they're there, the immatures are there. They haven't gotten covered by a waxy coating yet, but they've overwintered, and that's where you look for them. If you're looking on azaleas, you're looking on Ailanthus, you'll find them there. I'm not seeing real high populations here, so I don't think it's gonna be a real problem in this area. Also, you've got some root competition because it's a cherries and Styrax here, but really there's a lot of leaf litter. It's not a lot of compaction, so these guys are doing pretty well. They get some shade. So yeah, they're not gonna be as stressed as much, and then you don't have that pest issue that you normally would have. So the next thing I'd like to show you is, I don't know if you have hemlocks in your yard. I have a lot of hemlocks at my property, about 50 or so, that are about half the size of these two mature specimens that are here in the Cherry Border. But I just wanted to look at the two and compare the two, and kind of what I'm looking at right now as to woolly adelgid and elongate hemlock scale populations, which I look at this time of year. Okay, so I'm looking right now at a low branch of the hemlock, American or the Canadian hemlock, which is the Pennsylvania state tree. And unfortunately, for a number of years, I think mainly since the 80s, hemlock woolly adelgid has become a major pest for hemlocks. And really, your ancient stands have really been affected all the way up to Nova Scotia now. I just wanted to show you the females. I mean, it's just, they reproduce asexually. So these are all females that are heavily coated right now with their own protective kind of waxy coating. There's the underside, the silver part of the needles, and they're getting ready to lay eggs. So there's two generations of these guys per year, in the spring and the fall. I'm trying to use the chemicals that are less affecting other beneficials. And you also have to look at, okay, are there other things here that are attacking these guys? Are there any? It's a little early, it's cold today. It's a little early for twice stabbed lady beetles to be showing up. We use horticultural oil. At this time of year, we're already into like mid, late April. We'll be using a summer rate, which is a 2% rate. I look also on these needles and I'm looking for any kind of scale issues. They do have hemlock elongate scale. Is a hard scale, it's not a soft scale, so it's an armored scale, and I don't see any of that here, very little of it. So sometimes when you treat one thing, you get a high population of another if it doesn't affect that. So these look pretty good with scale. So in the woods, in the crumb woods, we have Dr. Worcester planted a lot of hemlocks, which are very mature now also, but they tend to be on the north sides where it's cooler and wetter, which there is their natural habitat, so they're not stressed. We don't spray in there. What I'm seeing is maybe you lose some lower limbs, but I see very little adelgid on them, and I think it's just that they're where they want to be. You have to think about that with your own plants. All right, so we are outside Kohlberg Hall and right under the sundial. So this is a pond cypress above us, which would not be able to survive without the irrigation system of this bed. But you think about it, this is very much a lot of stress on these plants, even with irrigation, because you have all this paving and hardscape. And really this, this roots of this plant are probably taking all the nutrients and competing with these shrubs quite a bit. So I knew these guys were stressed, and we always have an issue here with scale. Now, this is the Indian wax scale. It's a soft scale, and it tends to hide out. It tends to hide out around wherever it can hide. And this right now is the female, mature females are hanging all around the stems where they can be under all this leaf litter and needles from the pond cypress. So they're real easy to kind of like take off. Oh, and you see? So they crush real easily, and you have like a really red, almost like bloody look to them. So that's one way of getting rid of them. In fact, they were covering all these stems, and the crew there cleaned all them off. But they are dark. On the inside, they're brownish purple. And right now, they're full of eggs. And so within just a few weeks, all the eggs are going to be coming out. And then they will change into crawlers, and then they will, as soon as they crawl to a certain part on the stem, they'll attach, and that's where they'll stay the rest of their lives. But the females are coated, obviously, with that real heavy, waxy covering, so it's really impossible to treat with a pesticide because it's so thick, unless you use a systemic, and we don't want to do that. So what you do is you wait until these the eggs have turned into crawlers and they haven't attached yet. And because once they attach, they really start forming that wax again, slowly at first, but that's when they're most vulnerable. So I always know like the middle of May, end of May, the crawlers will be moving. They're tiny little like grains of pollen, reddish. And so I can hit them with horticultural oil again. So one of the things you could do, I mean, here it's very hard because there's knees from the pond cypress and everything else, and all this brush would be to clean out some of this stuff so that your population wouldn't be hiding in here through the winter. All right, so we are near the Science Center and off the parking lot at DuPont. and I wanted to look at some of these red maples. Yes, lanternfly red maples. So I just kind of wanted to show you what we still have left. You still have time. And I think there's a photo that's going to come up from last year showing hatch, first instars, nymphs of spotted lanternfly, and that was in the pinetum. But just looking at this branch here, we have, and if you look at, there's an egg mass, a very small one. You can scrape them with a card into some hand sanitizer in a bag and get rid of it that way. Or you can just crush it. And I'm doing that right now. I know. There you go. Also, this just shows that the females sometimes don't put a coating on them. They can break down over the winter, but that looks like it was never covered. And that also is easy to crush. So whatever you can do, whether it's scraping or smashing these guys, as far up as I can reach. I don't want everybody to get on their high ladders and go up trees. You can see where we had this yellow sticky bands before. So when the nymphs drop down and then climb up the next morning, this prevents them from coming anywhere farther up in the tree. So we'll probably reapply them. I didn't treat these trees at all with any kind of systemic. But there are some trees, we looked at the styrax. Those I did. If you do treat with a systemic insecticide, then you need to remember when the plant is flowering. You want to do it after the flower so you're not affecting pollinators. Try not to do very, very little of that, as little as possible. But I will put the sticky traps on. I'll try to get rid of as many of these as I can. But if you're removing one of these, you're removing 30 to 40 eggs at a time, so just remember that. It's good to go over your trees right now, especially red maple, silver maple. The peaceful sound you're hearing now is soon going to be disturbed by chainsaw two-stroke cycle engine noise, which is coming from brood X cicadas. Now, I expect in a couple of weeks, if you look around trees and things, you may see the exit holes from the young nymphs. What they do is they, over a week or two, they start making these holes with little like turrets at the top that are made of mud. You might see them about a half an inch in diameter. And they've been spending 17 years underground and they're ready to come out. Look for anything that's like pencil-sized stems. The females are the ones that do the ovipositing, and they will oviposit like up to 30 different places and put 10 eggs in at a time. So you'll have twig dieback in branches that are like pencil-sized oaks, maples, the species they tend to frequent. You're going to have some twig dieback, don't worry about it. You can just be pruning some of that out, or it'll just fall off eventually if it's a bigger tree. But they won't really affect a large oak like the class oak over here. A smaller oak or trees that are just recently been planted are things that you may be a little concerned with, especially like fruit growers. They tend to go after some of the fruit trees. The males are the ones that make all the noise with the beating of their abdomens. And especially when they get together in groups. So 17 years, cicadas, brood cicadas. There's three on the eastern part of the coast, up from all the way to the south, to the north. And two are ones that we deal with. Last one came in 2013, so they'll be back in 2030. These are from 2004. And I talked to Jeff Jabko, Director of Grounds, about what it was like in 2004, and he said things weren't that bad around here. There were a few out in my way, and then towards Lancaster County, especially in like Susquehannock Park, it was deafening. You know, they had the reddish eyes. They're different from the dog day cicadas that we see every year, which dog day, they show up in 85 degrees, you hear them singing or so. And you get the same kind of shells, that you get with the dog day cicadas. But the brood cicadas have red eyes, smaller bodies. So they come out of the soil and they'll stay on a shrub or a tree nearby and they'll dry out and their exoskeletons will come off anywhere from, it depends how cold or warm it is, from 4 to 5 days at the most. And then they go up in the trees and they mature a little bit and then they start their thing. And it's all usually done by mid-July. You won't see another one. With all these things, with the scales, with spotted lanternfly, it's really taking care of your plants and making sure they're happy during droughts and mulching and not mulching up to the trunk, but just giving them good things that they need to grow well and be happy, and then you'll have less issues with some of these pests.